Hi, and welcome back to MyExcelOnline.com. Today we have a fun lesson for you. First, we are going to go over several different ways to look up data. Next, we're going to go over the if statement. And then after that, we're going to go over some special sum statements. And then finally, we're going to cover the count statement. So first, there are three or four different ways that you can look up information. So we're going to start with an easy way to do that, and then we're going to go to the easier way to do that, and then we're going to go to the easiest way to do that. So the easy way is starting with something called match and index. In order to explain match and index and how you can use these two functions together, we're going to play a little game today. If you are familiar with the game The Price is Right, what used to happen on the show is at the end of the episode, the winner would go to a sort of winner circle and they would see three very big prizes and they would have to guess the prices of how much the sum total of these prizes would cost. The Price is Right originally had one contestant guessing at the end, but for the sake of our example today, we are going to have several guessers. I have 11 of them listed over here on the left, and each one of them has a guess as to what the total of this whole prize package is worth. So what I would like to do is find out who has the correct guess. Now, there's certain rules that came with The Price is Right, and usually you had to be the person who guesses the closest without going over. So we're going to try to stick to those rules, but I'm going to show you three different functions to see who the winner here is. Okay, I'm just looking for a free cell. I'm going to go right here into E. And I can look at that data right now, and I can see that no one has an exact match to our total. But I'm going to go here, and I'm going to go equals match. And then I'm going to write a parenthesis. Now, the lookup value, this is the value that I want to match. So that is going to be the actual sum of all of our prizes. If I put a comma in next, I'm going to be asked for a lookup array. That array is where all my data is. I don't want the names of the people in this one. I really just want the numbers. So when I highlight this group of numbers right here, this is going to be where I want to find the number that is closest to what's in K5. There's a final argument. If you look here, you can see match type. It's in brackets. That means it's an optional argument. So I'm going to go through each one of those arguments to let you know what they are. The first one is a zero, or an exact match. So if I click on that and I just hit enter, I'm going to get an NA. And that NA is actually correct because no one has guessed 38,548. I'm going to go over here and edit my data though and pretend that Olivia was very, very astute in her price guessing, and she actually did guess 38,548. When I hit enter, I'm going to go back to cell E2 and I'm going to see a number 10. What does that 10 mean? What that means is whoever was on the 10th row, starting here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. That is the winning number if I was looking for a perfect match. So we all know that no one is going to guess exactly what this prize package is worth. So I'm just going to hit Control Z on the keyboard and put Olivia's original answer of $50,000 back. Now, if I go up to my match formula up here and I click in the toolbar, I'm going to change this argument to a less than. When I double click on that and then hit enter, I am going to have a result of 5. So what that 5 is going to mean is if I come back to my data set and I go down, this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This person has guessed without going over. And if you look at the 38,000 and the 39,000, the 38,000 should be the winner because it is the closest without going over. So number 5 is the actual winner here. I do want to just explain the last argument here too. It was very important that my data was sorted correctly by number. But if I go up to data and I go to sort and I go from largest to smallest, I want you to watch what happens to my match number. It is now invalid. because it is searching for less than. However, if you look at column B, my data is sorted in a descending order right now. So if I go back and I change the final argument, instead of being a 1, if I change that to greater than in descending order, I will now be returned with a 6. This is the answer 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Now in this case, this is the closest number going over, but that violates our game's rules. So we really want the one that is closest without going over. If you look right here, I would like to give you a summary of the match arguments, that third argument that comes in the match function. If I put a 1, I'm looking for a less than, but I need to have my data sorted in ascending order from smallest to largest. If I put a 0, I'm looking for a number that is totally equal, so it doesn't matter what order my data is in. But if I put a negative 1 in there as that third argument, I'm looking for the greater than, and my data has to be sorted in descending order. I hope that makes sense to you. Okay, so now that I have the value, what I would really like to know, if I look over here, what name matches that value? Because this is giving you a location within my data set, but that's only giving you a number. So 38,000 is nice, but it doesn't tell me who the winner is that I can call down at the end of my contest. So right down here, I made a big box, and I'm going to use the index function to show you how the name of the winner would be automatically determined here. So I'm just going to write equals index. And the first argument that this function is asking for is an array. What data do I want to return here? And so I'm going to highlight the column of just the names. Now the next argument it's going to ask me for is, which row do I want? Well, seeing that the names are right next to the guesses, the number I want is whatever number appears here. So once I click on that and I hit enter, I'm returned with Noah as being the winner. So let's say that this total is not the real total. We had underestimated, and the price of the vacation is really $12,000. So if I change that and update it here, all of my calculations are going to change. Here's my little 6. Now it changed to the 6th data spot down, which is 39,000. And then the winner now is Luke, because we're looking over here for the name of the person. Is that correct though? If you look, it is still following the rule, because you have to be the lowest without going over. And the next one down, 42,534, is greater than the 42,011 that we have over here. So Luke actually is the winner. Say that we really, really overestimated the price of the new car, and the new car is actually a cheaper model of a car, and it's only going to be $20,000. So if I change the data there, now we're looking at a total of 34,576. And if you just look here with your eye yourself, you can see that this is the one that should be the winner. And the winner now is Will. If I would like to combine both of these formulas together and not have to use up a cell for using this number 3, I could basically just go up here and cut out this part of the function and click back down here on my winner cell. And instead of putting E2 in here, I could just paste the name of my function and hit enter, and I will still be getting Will in there. But let's look at the function again. I would just want to be able to read it with you. It says index A2 to A12, which is the names, match whatever's in K5, which is the price, and B2 to B12 is the price range that I need to look at. And the argument of 1 is coming back with a less than because it's in ascending order. So I hope that makes sense to you. The functions we use right here are called match, index, and then we use the combination of index with match so that we would be able to calculate the winner of our little game. Next, I would like to go over a function called VLOOKUP. If match index was the easy way to do something, VLOOKUP is the easier way to do something. So let's look at our data set over here. This is our array of data. We can treat this sort of like a database. Like I'm looking down here and I would like to find Will, and I would like to find what Will's original guess was on my spreadsheet down here. So I'm going to go click in this cell down here, and I'm going to type equals VLOOKUP. And I'm going to be asked for several arguments. The first argument is the lookup value. What am I looking up? I want to look up whatever is in this cell. My next argument is my table array, or where am I looking up that cell? And I'm going to highlight all of my data here. Notice how with match and index, I only highlighted one column, but with VLOOKUP, I can highlight two columns. But the interesting argument is the next one, the column index number. Once I find Will, what column will the data be in that I want to display here? In our case, column A will be column 1 for this argument, and column B will be column 2. I'm going to go with the 2 right here. And then I'm going to put in this optional argument right here. Am I requiring an approximate match or am I requiring an exact match? I'm going to say exact right here and double click on that and then just hit enter. And this is correct. This 33,879 is what Will's guess was. So let's try it again. Let's up our new car price back to about 28,000 and see if the winner changes and their guess changes. Now the winner is Mason, and Mason's guess was right under that. So the new winner is Mason, and we can also see what his guess was. So I'd like to go over a few caveats with the two functions that we have already learned. When you look at VLOOKUP, you have to take an argument right here. See that argument right there? It's got a 2. That means I'm looking at this column and any column forward. I can't start with column B and look back to column A unless I want to use the index function. But we have already seen that using the index function takes a few steps. So there is actually a newer function in Excel, and it's called XLOOKUP. And I'm going to put that in this cell right here. So in my cell, I'm going to type XLOOKUP, and I'm going to put my first parenthesis. Now the XLOOKUP function is really awesome. It takes all of the pain out of the order of your columns or knowing, do I want the second column? Does it start counting with a 0? Does it start counting with a 1? I don't know. So let me go over the XLOOKUP function and hopefully you'll see how great it is. Okay, so the very first thing I want to do here is select the lookup value. So I'm going to go back to this number right here. That's what I'm looking for. Which of my contestants is closest to this number? Next, I'm going to have a lookup array. Where am I looking for that number? So I'm going to select this data set right here. My next argument is going to be the return array. What data am I looking to return? Well, I want the name, and if you notice, the name is over here to the left. So if I highlight all of the names, I'm going to return the name of the winner. The next argument is really interesting. The if not found, and as you can tell, again, this is an optional argument because it's in the brackets, but I'm just going to say, I'm going to put into quotes, no winner, because that's what I want displayed here if no one has guessed. My next argument is a match mode, and I love this. Am I looking for an exact match, or am I looking for next smaller item? That one sounds a lot like the closest price without going over. The next one is exact match or next larger item. That would be the price that is just a little bit over what the actual winning price is. So for my case, I'm going to pick this argument right here because that's the rules of the game that we're playing. This last argument here is very interesting. Look up at our match arguments. Remember how we had to put in whether or not we wanted less than, equal, or greater than? But before we did that, we had to sort our data. Say I don't want to sort my data here. I'm going to pick search first to last as my argument here. and let's see what happens. I'm going to hit enter. And right now, all of our results are saying that Mason has won. But let's test which function really truly is better. I'm going to go over to my data here, and I'm not going to sort the guesses in an ascending or descending order. Instead, I'm going to go sort by the guesser, and that will mix up my numbers so they're not sorted correctly. When I do that, if you notice, my X lookup right here kept Mason as the winner because he really is the winner. Once I resorted my data, you can see that the XLOOKUP is putting Mason as the winner. But the index match over here is putting Noah as the winner. Noah is not the correct winner. But if you look over here, the data is not sorted. If I went and sorted the data back correctly and sorted it by guess from smallest to largest, because we're looking for less than or equal to, it will go back to Mason. But that's the issue with the index formula, is you have to be able to sort those fields correctly. The XLOOKUP does not care if the data is already pre-sorted. It just goes through, unless you change that last argument, it just goes through and it looks at each data point and it keeps track of which one is less than, closest to that number without going over. I hope that has cleared up the differences between match and index, VLOOKUP, and XLOOKUP. And I hope now that you have an understanding of XLOOKUP, you'll be able to find some projects to use it in.
If you like this video, then give it a thumbs up. And don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel. And if you're really serious about advancing your Microsoft Excel and Office skills so you can stand out from the crowd and get the jobs, promotions, and pay rises that you deserve, then click up here and join our Academy online course today.